Thank you. Hey, thank you for getting that microphone going. I don't know what we did without those. Well, welcome to Sunday School. I wanted to lift up some of our favorite missionaries today. That's an inside joke. All of our missionaries are our favorite missionaries because they go while we send. Today on the back of our church handout, if you picked one up, is Justin and Rachel Rhodes. They are missionaries to London. We supported them since 2019, and if I ever went anywhere, I guess I'd go wherever God called me, but I would love to go to London. We went to London in 2010 for our 25th wedding anniversary. We went to Scotland and Wales. And I had an accent by the third day, and I was wearing a tweed cap by the end of the week. I was ready to go. We traced our families back, northwest Scotland and England and Wales, a lot of Welsh people, and I was very intrigued. But Justin and Rachel were in London. London is a dead and dying town, despite being the hub of civilization for 100 years or more. It's 90% of people there say that Jesus Christ is not the only way to heaven. It is just a profoundly post-Christian organization. And we are the recipients of the gospel from our British cousins, and now it's a joy to try to go back and help them that they've fallen on hard times. Justin and Rachel are doing a great job. The buildings in London are empty, and the government has to be given credit because if you can whip up 8 or 12 people, they will give you the title of that building. And they have congregations of 8 to 12 that have beautiful stone gathering places that are just gorgeous and were built 100 years ago. So that's what they're doing over there. They are trying to mentor British pastors, train church leaders, fill empty pulpits, revamp existing dying ministries, and impact London, the great city. We've supported them, and by giving to Faith Promise Missions, you get to be part of this. I'd love to go over there and visit these particularly, and I'd like to do it without shame and tell that I have been helping with them. We'll go to the book of Ruth. We're in the third lesson out of four, a short series titled Redeeming Love. It's the story of Ruth. And today's lesson is called Five Ways to Draw Closer to Jesus Christ. We studied that this story in the Old Testament, like all stories in the Old Testament, is written for our admonition and instruction. The pictures are actual, the stories are literal, but they also have an application to personal lives and prophetically. Ruth is a wonderful picture of the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, somebody that's born outside the covenant of God and brought in by the actions of a kinsman redeemer. The Lord Jesus is pictured in the story by Boaz, a mighty good man. Your grandmother might say, a mighty and a good man. Somebody said, Lord, I want to see you more clearly. I want to follow you more nearly. I want to love you more dearly. That's exactly what Ruth wants to do in her picture of the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, as she is wedded and welded and follows throughout life her heavenly bridegroom, the Lord, the man Boaz. So Ruth is a story. It's a true story, but there's also a story behind the story, and we studied that the last few weeks. Ruth, this pagan, is outside the people of God in that day. She is not a member of the nation of Israel, and she is brought to faith by her Lord and in her Lord. She marries Boaz, an Old Testament picture of the Lord Jesus Christ. We talked last week, if they were advertising for this now, it would be the maid from Moab is wedded to the bachelor from Bethlehem. That's the idea. And they live happily ever after. And truly, this marriage was made in heaven. The whole scene takes part during the barley harvest, and Boaz owns the field. The law of the land is that the corners are left for the poor and the indigent. The laborers work for him. Boaz is Ruth's former husband who died's relative. She's now a widow, and soon she's to be married to Boaz. She is to marry well, and Naomi's watching out for this. So a close and intimate relationship now, we'll study today, between Ruth, the bride, and her new groom, Boaz, picturing Christ. Look in Ruth chapter 3. Verse 1, and I like Naomi. Naomi is an old, sharp woman who's going to make sure that Ruth doesn't just fiddle around. She wants this marriage to happen. It will help all of them, and it's the right thing to do. And young people sometimes are quiet, and she's giving her the elbow, like, get in there, go, go, go. Ruth 3, verse 1, then Naomi, her mother-in-law, said unto her, my daughter, shall I not seek rest for thee, that it may be well with thee? Don't you want rest and refreshment and all that your heart yearns for? You know what? There's a proverb that says, the wise woman buildeth her house, but the foolish plucketh it down with her hands. This is an older woman telling a younger woman, marry the right man, build up your house, and have a good future. And we need that. In chapter 3, verse 2, and now is not Boaz of our kindred, and whose maidens thou wast? Behold, he winnoweth barley tonight in the fresh threshing floor. So he's out there throwing up the barley and the chaff blows away, and the barley remains. And now here's Naomi's advice to Ruth on how to get to and stay close to her groom, Boaz, and our picture of the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 3. Wash thyself, therefore, and anoint thee, put thy raiment upon thee, get thee down to the floor, but make not thyself known unto the man until he shall have done eating and drinking. And it shall be, when he lieth down, that thou shalt mark the place where he shall lie. Thou shalt go in, uncover his feet, lay thee down, and he will tell thee what thou shalt do. And she said unto her, all that thou sayest unto me I will do. Most people, you can't say that. But someone who loves you and that you've followed and you've known for years, like Naomi, it's wise to do it. So here's the setting. Five ways for us as the New Testament Ruth to draw close to Christ, the truth of which Boaz was but a picture. Christianity is not a code, a creed. It's not a program of conduct. It's a relationship. It is Christ. If you have $1 million, you're a millionaire. Doesn't matter whether you drive an old farm truck and overalls and chew tobacco. You are a millionaire because you possess $1 million. You're not a Christian by following a code, signing a pledge. All those things are fine. You're a Christian if you possess the Lord Jesus Christ. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things passed away. Behold, all things become new. So Christianity and a Christian is one who loves Jesus Christ more than redemption, that relationship which is reestablished, which God intended and we lost in Adam and Eve, is reestablished, more than gifts. Gifts are great. You appreciate and you love the giver, and that grows over time. We want to know Christ and not about him. I believe in Bible study. That's my main role in the church, is a Bible teacher. I enjoy that. But if you don't watch out, you know about Christ by Bible study. But if you know these things, happy are ye if you do them. Obedience lets you know Christ. I could read about you and learn a lot, but if I walk with you, I'm going to learn tremendously more. And there's no duality there. You can have both. Philippians chapter 3, verse 10 says, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death. When you walk with somebody all the way through life, like married couples do, to the end, till death do you part, you know that person. And that's the picture for us in the New Testament of what's going on here. Here is wonderful advice to know our Redeemer, like Ruth learned to know Boaz with the instruction of Naomi. Number one, in these five ideas for us as New Testament Christians, be freshly cleansed. Look in verse 3. Wash thyself, therefore, and anoint thee, and put thy raiment upon thee. If you're going to meet somebody that you might want to impress, clean up, shine up. There's nothing spiritual about looking like an unmade bed. It's okay to take a bath, comb your hair, and freshen up a little bit. You've been out working all day, and we thank you for it. But now this is a different matter here. James 4:8 says, draw nigh to God, he'll draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hand, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. You draw near to the one you love, your Redeemer. You must be clean. God can deal with any life except an uncleansed one. Many complain, my prayers are not answered. Why? Well, let me read you a verse here. Isaiah 1:15 through 16. When you spread forth your hands, I'll hide my eyes from you. Yea, when you make many prayers, I'll not hear. Your hands are full of blood. Wash you, make you clean, put away the evil of your doings before mine eyes. Cease to do evil. I love America. I love July 4th. But frankly, when we very demandingly say, God bless America, God can't bless America with 73 million aborted babies. That's, I can't watch anymore about what happened down in Texas. I told my wife, I'm not going to watch this. It's making me sick. 19 children. Well, they're with the Lord now, and they also are gathered into a great fold of 70 or 75 million children that were killed before they could draw one breath. Can God bless America? Well, America's in the repenting mode right now. That's what we have to do first. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1 also says, having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. And so there's a spiritual application of this physical picture, that we are to keep a short sin account. Psalm 51 and 1 John 1, 9. And if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And then the psalm, create in me a clean heart, O God, renew a right spirit in me, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Short sin accounts. Don't tell me you haven't sinned. Your wife and dog are in the building. We know you're lying. Don't do that. But keep a short sin account. You can't be perfect, but you can be forgiven. Isaiah, another one, 52. There's all sorts of Old and New Testament verses about us staying cleansed from the putrefaction of sin. Isaiah 52:11, depart ye, depart ye, go ye out from thence, touch no unclean thing, go ye out of the midst of her, be ye clean that bear the vessels of the Lord. Don't get your nose up and think you'll never sin. You will, but you stay clean. That's the idea. This maiden wanting to be near her bridegroom is not going to do very well when she comes in just covered with all sorts of stuff from working out in the yard all day, sweaty and grimy and dirty and ugly. Who doesn't even care enough to bathe? That's not very wise. Freshly clean. Naomi said, you know, I took a bath yesterday. No, that doesn't work. You know, that's what my grandson does. Did you wash your hands? Yeah. Let's feel it. Awfully dry, aren't they? Awfully dry. Oh, I washed them yesterday. That's not good enough. How do we get clean in our approach to the Lord? How's this application for us as New Testament Christians? Number one, we get clean in our life, and you know this, by the Word of God. The Word of God is in lots of pictures, but one of them is cleanliness. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25 and 26 says, we are clean through the washing of the water of the Word. And the Word of God is to your spirit what water in your shower is to your body. Psalm 119, verses 9 and 11, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereto, according to thy word. Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee. You've done that, I've done that. A wise person taught me that early in my Christian life. He said, well, you're a businessman. There's going to be people in here, and they'll send in salespeople, and some of them will be batting their long eyelashes at you, and you don't want to get in trouble. I'll give you a verse. And he did. And he said, for the lips of a strange woman drop as in honeycomb, and her mouth is smoother than oil. Her end is bitter as wormwood, sharp as a two-edged sword. Her feet go down to death. Her steps take hold on hell. He said, that'll kind of change the atmosphere in the room. If you would write that across her forehead in gold letters, you know, that's kind of, and you know what? The Holy Spirit will bring up that rhema, that word from the word, from the treasury and the armory, and use it. And we still have to, you know, bring it up and do it. We're not robots, but it does help. That's the idea. James says the Bible is like a mirror. The Word of God reveals sin. We talked last week, Romans 3:20, by the deeds of the law shall no flesh be justified in his sight, but because by the law is the knowledge of sin. That's a good start, but you need cleansing. We don't just read the Bible. The Bible reads us. The Word reveals this solution. Number one, we can stay freshly cleaned in our life and approachable to the Lord, and he can have easier fellowship with us when we're not covered with the filth of sin by the word of God. Number two, you are actually cleansed by the operation of the blood. 1 John 7, chapter 1, verses 7 through 9. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. You say, I don't have any sin. Well, if you say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth's not in us. So you may lie about other stuff too. This is not a good start. Verse 9, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now that is a good verse. That's the one for you and me. No longer pretending that you haven't sinned. No longer pretending it's God's fault. Just confessed up. Number one is this: be freshly cleansed. That's the idea. You say, well, and by the way, did you notice that it said if we confess our sins? There is a difference. I got a thing yesterday. Your auto renewal at Sam's didn't go through. I forgot we had a new credit card, so I did that. When you go to Sam's, you're dealing wholesale. I'll take aisle four, put it out in my truck, and I'll have 10,000 rolls of toilet paper. Yes, we're set for the future. This is great. That's wholesale. We often want to repent wholesale. You've forgotten about God all day. You've been living in the flesh. It's time to go to bed. The Holy Spirit taps you on the shoulder. You're saying, forgive me all my sins in Jesus' name. Amen. Time to go to bed. No. If you want to get dynamic, you get specific. You name it, you nail it. Sins is plural, and it means every individual sin. When you've been mean to your wife all day, you don't say, and forgive me, Lord, for being mean to my wife all day. You should say, honey, I really messed up today. She go, really? Who would have thought that? She knows that. And I should have said this in the morning, and I should have done that, and I made a mistake, and I really was wrong. And when you go down through every one, you've got a good chance of clearing the air and practical fellowship is reestablished. Not when you do it wholesale, but when you do it retail. And remember, confessing and repenting is not just agreeing. It is, but it also is, it's not just admission, it's agreement and confession. Confession in the Greek is homologeo. It means to say the same as God does. When you say, well, that's just me, we're a bunch of redheads and we got a hot temper. No, you're just mean. And your spouse knows that. And you need to not just say, well, I guess I was wrong. Well, I guess you were. You need to say, I was wrong about this. Will you forgive me? I confess. Be cleansed and rejoice in that the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin. Number one, be freshly cleansed. Number two, that's the bad part, getting clean. Now you've got a blank sheet of paper. What are you going to do now? Be fragrantly consecrated. Look in chapter 3, verse 3 again. Wash thyself, therefore, and anoint thee. Now, we have our two little dogs. We just got one of them's birthday's tomorrow, and I guess it'll be on the TV news and everything, but tomorrow we got a little hat for him. We're very silly about our dogs. We love dogs. And dogs love lotion. So my wife fights this battle every day. She comes out of the bedroom there, and she's gotten all cleaned up for the day, and she apparently uses some kind of lotion on her legs because the dogs go crazy. And they start licking her. She goes, no, I don't want to smell like a dog or anything. That these dogs love lotion. I laughed about that until I got this new stuff, this balm, instead of aftershave that stings. This is a balm. It feels good. And the dogs are going all over me. So within a few minutes, we're not very elegant at all. We're both covered with dogs after us. Ruth is not going to do that. Ruth, Naomi says, put on some perfume. You know, the old thing in the New Testament, is it a sin for women to wear makeup? It's a sin for most women not to wear makeup. So we just get that settled right here. And the same way with the lotion and the anointing. It's okay. Don't major on that. But it's there. It's okay. It's nice to look good, to feel good. That's okay. Brides were anointed. Priests were anointed. A wonderful aroma can go with a good anointing. And it's nice to be clean, and people like to be around you. And if you smell good, it doesn't hurt. I mean, you don't need to go overboard, but this is okay. What was Spurgeon's favorite book in the Bible? By far, the Song of Solomon. You can go to spurgeongems.net or .org and see how many sermons he preached on each chapter of the Bible, which was amazing. I mean, it's thousands and thousands of sermons. But his favorite book by far was the Song of Solomon, we being the bride and Christ being the beloved. It speaks of the beloved being like a cluster of spices, of myrrh and of aloe, of all the chief spices. The fragrance spoke of love and intimacy. So we are in our life, it's hard to stay clean. Number one, we're cleansed by the word, but we are anointed by the Holy Spirit. I'll read you the verse, 1 John chapter 2, verse 27. But the anointing which ye have received. Boy, this is not difficult Bible study. This is exactly what we're talking about. The anointing which you have received of him abideth in you. You need not that any man teach you, but as the same anointing teacheth you of all things, and is truth, and is no lie, and even as it hath taught you, ye shall abide in him. This is a close work. Now that you're clean, now your life is going to bear a fragrance and fruit if you walk with the Lord Jesus, and his spirit and your spirit are one. That's going to be great. The Holy Spirit is the connector here. We're cleansed by the word. We're anointed by the Holy Spirit. Dr. Rogers taught this. The anointing we have is the Spirit of God. When I'm clean and filled with the Holy Spirit and come before the Lord, he is well pleased with that. Then we are marked by the fragrance of Christ, because his spirit is alive in us. To be anointed and surrendered to the Holy Spirit of God, your life could be like incense to him. I'll tell you this, I'm not looking around, you're all my friends. There are people like that, when they come in the room, it is a breath of fresh air. A lot of people brighten up a room just by leaving it. Admit it, it's true. I hope it's not you. A lot of people will rain on your parade just because that's what they like to do. And they were born in a pickle vat and baptized in lemon juice and weaned on persimmons, and they're just as sour as they can be. And they just, and they, you know, they've got the gift of criticism, and I wish they'd go somewhere else. But there are people, and some of them are in this room, that when you come into my life, it is wonderful. When I look on my clinic schedule every morning, I see about 10 people in the morning, about 7 in the afternoon. Every morning I get that clinic schedule and I look down there, and what I'm looking for is sore heads and wackos. That's what I'm looking for. I think, oh, please let me have, oh, they're so nice. Oh, we'll have a great time. Oh, this. And I go, oh, no. 10:45, the battleship Missouri enters the harbor, you know. These are the people, you know, it said that Baptists would vote for the rapture, you know, 12 to 4. These are the people that would have vote against anything that anybody's trying to do. But I know people that brighten up my day, and my nurses even know sometimes. They always put somebody really nice and friendly near the end of the day just to cheer me up after fighting the unhappy people all day. Number one, be freshly cleansed by the word and by the blood, and then be fragrantly consecrated. The indwelling Holy Spirit is wonderful. It is joyful. He is wonderful. And I can detect him in you, and when you're filled with the Spirit, and people come in, I can just tell sometime in my office, I'll say, how are you doing? I mean, they are just glowing. And they say, well, I got up earlier today and spent some time with the Lord. I went, yeah, I thought so. I'm so glad to have them in my life. Number three. Not only cleansed, not only consecrated. This is, remember, about Ruth and Boaz, but it's about us and Christ. Be fitly clothed. Look again in chapter 3, verse 3. Wash thyself. We've talked about that. Anoint thyself. We've talked about that. Put thy raiment upon thee and get thee down to the floor. You're going to go see somebody that you hope will marry you. And these people weren't shy back then. They had they wanted to meet each other, and it said, you know, most women pick out their husband. The husband just thinks he picks out the woman. And this Naomi and her were they were on target. They said, this is our hope and this is our future, to develop again the relationship in our families and the covenant that I could be in if I married Boaz. She is dressed probably in widow's garments. And she's also been out there. As nice as they are, it's still probably a black outfit and old dusty and dirty and out in the field. And Naomi said, I got an idea. Burn that outfit. Burn it. We're through with that. You're cleaned up. You're anointed. Let's get some beautiful clothes for you that'll make you look even better. And you're going to see Boaz. Freshen up, girl. I mean, these old women, they know. They're smart. Isaiah 61, verses 1 through 3, talks about this garment. This is Billy Sunday's verse when he started to preach every time he preached. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn. Here we come. To appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. Good news, bind up the brokenhearted and liberty to the captive, and it includes a garment of praise which drives away the spirit of heaviness. I like biographies a lot. Moody had one guy, they ended up having a big meeting in Chicago, and all these preachers were there, and he invited somebody to open them up in prayer, and this guy started to pray around the world and under the table, and 5 minutes went by, and 8 minutes went by, and 12 minutes went by, and everybody's just about to pass out, and Moody stepped up and said, as Brother Smith catches up on his prayer life, let's move on with the meeting. So he wanted to keep things going, and he also said, he said, some people's prayer meetings, whether personal or other, are like calves dying in a hailstorm. It's just unhappy. He said, would it hurt to shove out a few of those groans and insert a few hallelujahs into your prayers? It might make a difference. You have a lot to be thankful for. Well, that's exactly what's going on here. We are to be clothed not only by belonging to the Lord and being married to him and clean by application of the word of God, which directs us back to the work Christ did for us by his blood, and then freshly consecrated by the indwelling Holy Spirit, who we ought to get filled with and controlled by every morning and yield our life to him. And now praise ought to be marked in our life. People that praise God, and I'm not talking about fake or silly, your cup can overflow, but don't tip it over. That's the idea. Some people just put on a show. But if you really are praising the Lord for what he's done appropriately and joyfully, people just respond to it. This world is dying. Russians are treating Ukrainians like animals, little children shot and things. And again, the abortion mills are just like grinding in the background. This is a sad, dark world. We have promises for today and promises for the future. Billy Sunday said, if you put those hallelujahs into your prayer, he'll be more real to you than your old, staid, stale, take it or leave it prayers. Not only be fitly clothed, Ruth, as far as Boaz, says Naomi, and also the Holy Spirit says to you, says to me, regarding Christ and the watching world, be fully committed. Ruth has decided, and Naomi have decided, that this is a wonderful opportunity, that Boaz is a wonderful man. It will solve the family problem, and it will also solve the inheritance problem and a future and a place for them. I mean, they're just out scrabbling as hard as they can to get gleanings by handfuls in the corners. Look in Ruth chapter 3, verse 3 again. We just said, put thy raiment upon thee. Get down to the floor. Make not thyself known unto the man until he should have done eating and drinking. And it shall be when he lieth down, thou shalt mark the place where he shall lie. Thou shalt go in, uncover his feet, lay thee down. He'll tell thee what thee should do. She is going to physically say, I want you. Do you want me? And he has wanted her before she even knew about him. He was immediately attracted to her. Now, people say, oh, this is, she's going into bed. She is not. And look in verse 11. Now, my daughter, fear not, I will do to thee all that thou requirest, for all the city of my people doth know thou art a virtuous woman. He's not doing anything bad. I'll tell you what he's doing. I grew up most of my life in Tennessee, my whole life. We lived in Missouri 7 years. The 4 years of high school and 3 years of college, I was up in Missouri in a little town about like this. Well, in the summer, in August, was the county fair, and the 4-H barn had all the pigs and all the cows and all the animals. Every night, if you went down there, you could see all those little kids and all the little families in their sleeping bags. Everybody slept in that barn. Everybody was under the same blanket in that family. That's the idea. This threshing floor was communal property. There were dozens of families there. All of them. There was nothing going wrong here. She is saying, I want you to be my Lord. That's the Old Testament idea of a husband in the days. She said, I want to be fully committed to you. And you know what? The most sacred place that we can be is at the feet of the Lord Jesus, which positionally says, you are Lord, I will do what you say. That's full commitment. Boaz, asleep on the threshing floor, pulls back the corner of his long garment, places her at his feet, covers her over. She says, I am willing to take you as my Lord and my husband. Ruth 3:11 again. The word skirt is the same word as wings. Remember that? We talked about that coming under the wings of the protection of Jehovah. The picture of him almost like, you know, a chicken with the little chicks underneath it. She is saying, I literally place myself under your protection. I am fully committed to you to be my husband and my kinsman redeemer and to redeem my land and to bring life and joy back into my family and to help Naomi and to plan for a future. She was in the line genetically of the Lord Jesus Christ. She didn't know that then. You talk about what a bright future. Rahab was in the line. What a changed life. Ruth was in the line, a cursed Moabite from a nation initiated by incest and just anathema to God. Whatever background you come from, it's not as bad as being a Moabite in those days or as bad as being a Rahab in those days. This is what Christ does. He takes you from way down low to put you way up high. Question, can you have a intimate, growing, joyful relationship practically to the Lord Jesus Christ if you're not fully committed to him? Three answers and the first two don't count. No, of course not. Absolutely not. Is Christ Lord? Are we at his feet? I listen to the Bible Gateway audio Bible as I go to sleep and then when I wake up sometimes. I'm really working on this because, do you fight this battle? I'm sure you don't. You're very spiritual looking. When you first wake up, what's the first thing you do? If I don't watch out, it's to read the stupid email. I mean, there is nothing that I need to know. It's 5 o'clock in the morning initially about some, you know, sale or something like that. If I can just listen to that just for a little bit in the morning to get started, start off with God's Word. And I can read the email later. There's nothing wrong with email. But that's the idea, is placing yourself practically at Jesus' feet. Here's another day. You've kept me through the night. Mary, in the section that was playing on the audio Bible today, Mary and Martha were watching for Jesus to come. They were kind of mad or kind of hopeful about Lazarus. And both of them said, you know, if you'd been here, this wouldn't have happened. You know, they're still, even though he's Lord, they're not happy with him at this point. And Mary, though, sat at the feet of Jesus. It's a good habit. We can sit in the pew or the pulpit, but at the feet of Jesus, either way is better. Next one, not only fully committed after fitly clothed, but faithfully compliant. Look in chapter 3 and verse 4. And it shall be when he lieth down that thou shalt mark the place where he shall lie. Thou shalt go in, uncover his feet, and lay thee down. He'll tell thee what they ought to do. And she said, all that thou sayest to me, I will do. I was reading Luke 2 in another Bible thing this weekend. And Mary said regarding Jesus, everything he tells you, do it. You say, well, what she meant? No, she meant everything he tells you, do it. And that's amazing. You know, I have people that say, I say, well, your blood pressure's still up. I don't know about them pills. There's a friend of mine on the internet that said they turned your hair green, you fell over dead, and it was just really not a good thing. He said, but I'm worried about my blood pressure being up. I said, well, I got to admit, it's a funny thing about these pills. They work a lot better when you take them. It's just me. That's just how I feel. Don't tell me you're not bitter when you haven't tried what I said. And I'm not right every time. Of course, I'm wrong plenty. Jesus is never wrong, ever. That's the idea. So what's the picture here? Ruth's ready to obey and not to be a hearer of the word only, but a doer. And Boaz wasn't perfect, but in the picture, he's a picture of somebody who was perfect, who we deal with. This is the key to be close to the heavenly Boaz. You can't be near somebody if you're not walking with them and obeying them in that sense. At his feet without hearing and obeying his word won't work. No, and the answer needs to be yes. We've talked about this before, and I'm not a good illustration of it, but there are good Christians in this room that do this. When you come to Jesus about the plans for the day or the week or the month or your life, we're supposed to sign the bottom of the page and hand it back to him. I'm in this big group now, hundreds of doctors, because there are 60 offices in Knoxville and everything. Anyway, we have a lawyer in our office, and he is very good at it. The older you get, the more you appreciate a lawyer, I'll tell you that. But he always says, if you are going to sign anything that you have any doubts about, send it to me. Let me read it. Let me study it. Let me think about it. If I told him, yeah, I've got a piece of paper here, I'm going to sign at the bottom, and anybody can write in whatever they want at the top, and I'll do it, he would have a stroke, right? That's the idea. We shouldn't do that for most people, but for Christ, that's exactly what we should do. John 7:17, I don't have time to tell you the story, but B.H. Carroll was saved by John 7:17, the great Baptist theologian of the Civil War days. He came back from the Civil War, a crippled, bitter veteran. And a preacher got up and preached John 7:17, which says, you probably know this already, if any man will do his will, he shall know of the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself. And he basically gave a challenge. He said, if you'll get the Gospel of John, which according to John 20:31 is written that you might know that Jesus is the Christ, and believe and or do everything that is said in there, by the time you're halfway through, God will reveal himself to you, and you will know the doctrine, whether it be made up or whether it's true. And they said, anybody want to come forward? And B.H. Carroll came forward. And everybody started cheering, and he put his hand up, and he said, no, I'm not coming to accept Christ, but I'll accept that challenge. And it wasn't a few weeks before he came to Christ through that verse that he was serious about this. Surrender your will to the Lord, that's what you do, and God will teach you. Here's what I would say. Now, you show me what you want me to do, and I'll think about it, and I might just do it. I might surprise you someday. You know, whenever you invite people to church, I've got 100 people there. I might surprise you one day. You're not going to surprise me. You're not going to do anything. But here's what the idea is. I'll do it. Tell me what it is now. That's what we should do. John 14:21 is a great verse. John 14:21 says, he that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I shall love him and shall manifest myself unto him. Oh, that's a powerful verse. If you feel that you are not walking with Christ and he's not real to you, or I do it, you know what it is? We're not doing what he says. If he says, I'm going to walk from here down to Weigel's and get a drink, and I go down to the highway and head toward the football field at the high school, they'll say, is Christ close to you? I don't feel close to Christ today. You know why? He's almost to Weigel's, and you're almost down to the football field. You can't be close to somebody if you don't go where they go and do what they do and walk with them. That's the idea, especially if they're Christ. He that hath my commandments, all right, we've got them, and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, I shall love him, and shall manifest myself unto him. If you do what Christ says, and you're walking in what he does, and you're going to be rubbing elbows with him all day, every day, and he'll be real to you. Fully compliant, God says, I'll be real to you. Do you know God by Bible study? Yes. Do you know Him fully by Bible study? No, because some people can study the Bible just like a bug collection or something. Isaac Asimov, I love science fiction growing up. I'd still like to go back and read some of those stories, were great. He wrote Asimov's Guide to the Bible. He came to it completely as an agnostic, and he never got saved. And he had an 800-page outline of the Bible. And of course, he understood the Bible. H.G. Wells, you know, outline of history. He said that Christ was the greatest person that ever lived in terms of impact. But as far as I know, he never was saved. Nothing wrong with studying, and we should. But walking with God is the thing. What good is Hebrew if you don't know Him, or Greek? Bible study gives you knowledge about God. Through obedience, you know God. Remember that verse. If you know these things, happy are ye if you do them. There's a lot of, that would save a lot of doctor visits. Not everybody. I'm not saying that at all. Why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things I do? Now, this is very convicting because we don't do all these things. But it's clear that we should. Boaz was near, dear, and clear to Ruth, for she said, whatever he says to me, I'll do. Now watch, we're almost through. Watch Boaz's response to his bride. Well, get out of here. I never liked you anyway. Those Moabites are a bunch of lowlifes. No, no, that's what Christ should have said to you and me when we came to Him. He should have said, I'll not be in a club that you're a member of, buddy. You just get out of here. But He didn't. He received her. Look in Ruth chapter 3, verse 8. It came to pass at midnight that the man was afraid. Have you ever, the other night, I had in my bedroom, I heard this sound. Bzz, bzz, bzz. I thought, it's outside, it's a squirrel. We have a lot of squirrels. And finally, I turned the light on, it was a moth, and it got stuck somewhere, but it was just, bzz, it scared me to death. So here's like Boaz. It came to pass at midnight, the man was afraid, turned himself, and behold, a woman lay at his feet. Now, he didn't know who it was or what was going on, but this is pretty, you know, like, what in the world's going on here? And he said, who art thou? And she said, I am Ruth, thine handmaid. Spread therefore thy skirt over thy handmaid, for thou art a near kinsman. They both knew what that meant, a near kinsman. If he married her, all her property would be redeemed. Her life would be different. She's saying, I'm willing, or you? Remember that Dickens play about Barkis is willing, about this coachman that always wanted to marry the cook in the house. He said, if you see that lady, remind her, Barkis is willing. And they did get married at the end. Ephesians 1:3 says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Ruth was to be blessed in Boaz, and Boaz was also going to be blessed by Ruth. But just like us in Christ, she got the greater blessing because He was able to help her more. Same way, Ephesians 1:3 and other verses, when we come to Christ, we get the blessing because we don't deserve any of this, and Christ is being extremely kind and merciful and condescending and faithful and wonderful. That's the idea. Number one, Boaz received her. Christ received you. Number two, He reassured her. She's a wonderful girl, but she's a young person just like anywhere else. And you know what? She's frightened. She had grown up in the wrong place. She married a pretty nice guy, and he died. And now she's back, and apparently she's a cursed person now, and this is no good. Nobody wants to be a cursed person. Ruth 3, verse 11. Now, my daughter, fear not. Boy, it's good to have somebody with power and strength and a good heart who says to you, I got this. Don't worry. I'll take care of it. Most people, you'd say, you can't do it. He could do it. I will do to thee all that thou requirest, for all the city of my people doth know that thou art a virtuous woman. And now it's true that I am thy near kinsman. Howbeit, there is a kinsman nearer than I. Tarry this night, it shall be in the morning, that if he will perform unto thee the part of a kinsman, well, let him do the kinsman part. But if he will not do the part of a kinsman to thee, then will I do the part of a kinsman to thee, as the Lord liveth. Lie down till morning, take a good rest, don't worry about it. I'm going to take care of this. If he wants to be your near kinsman and marry you, I can't stop that. But I think he knew the guy pretty well. He said, I'm pretty sure I'm going to be able to take care of this. And you're going to be in a whole different situation pretty soon. He spoke peace to her trembling heart. And she knew that he loved her. That means everything. Remember that song about the plans I have for thee? Oh, it's a wonderful song. Perfect love cast out fear. He loved her before she loved him, but now it's coming together. A perfect love cast out fear. Here's a good quote. It's not your perfect love for God, because you don't have that, that cast out fear, but God's perfect love for us that cast out fear. A good paraphrase of that concept, which is illustrated here, is we have no need to fear one that loves us perfectly. Only one person loves you perfectly. That's Christ. But he's an everlasting love. Number three, not only he received her, he received you, that is Christ. He reassured her. God said that he, if ever he loved you, he loves you forever. It's a done deal. Number three, he replenished her. He loaded her down. She had a shawl, and she said, I'm going to go out and get some gleaning. She said, your gleaning days are over. Well, let's head down to Sam's and get 100 pounds of stuff and load it in there and also put it in your car for free delivery. It's going to your house. We'll just flood Naomi with whatever you need. More than she needed. One commentator said he estimated 60 pounds of barley. Two little women are not going to eat 60 pounds of barley a day. He just was in a good mood. He was in an overwhelming, above and beyond. He said, absolutely. More than she needed, exceedingly abundantly, more than she could ask or think. Look at verse 16. When she came to her mother-in-law, she said, who art thou, my daughter? Man, you look completely different. Your face is lit up like a candle. And she told her all that the man had done to her. And you know what Naomi was saying? She said, got a ring? Are you the new Mrs. Boaz? Can we tell it to everybody in the paper? And in verse 18, it says, sit still, my daughter, until thou know how the matter will fall, for the man will not be in rest until he shall has finished the thing this day. That's the right kind of man. He wasn't monkeying around. He said, you know what? I'm going to make this happen. And he was the kind of person that you'd believe it. A lot of people say that, and they don't. But he did. And it was wonderful for her. Jesus, our Boaz, came to earth. You see him in the temple about his father's business. But you know what? He didn't stop. He said, I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day. So then they spit on him, mocked him, beat him. He didn't quit. He could have called 10,000 angels. He said, no, I've got work to do. It's appointed unto me to go to the cross. He got up on the cross. He could have come down. They said, come down. Half a flick of his finger. Remember that sermon, John Phillips, five mighty works on the cross. He blanked out the sun. He shook the earth. He split the rug wide open that was on the top of the temple. One little thing of his finger, he could have obliterated the people that were nailing him to the cross. He said, no, my work's not done. But now it is finished. Tetelestai, it is done. Now the man is resting, sitting at the right hand of the Father. He did it, and guess what? You and I can rest because, like Ruth with Boaz, you can count on our heavenly Boaz, the Lord Jesus Christ, to finish the work and do it all the way. All the way means including glorification. We've been justified. We're being sanctified. Half a heartbeat, we could be in heaven, or when we die and then resurrected, we are going to be glorified. And Boaz is a wonderful picture of Christ, and Ruth is a wonderful picture of us. Well, one more lesson about Ruth, and then we'll be through with that short series. Lord, thank you for Boaz. Thank you for Christ. And we were born wrong. We lived wrong. We don't deserve any of this. And your love is shed abroad and placed on us just irrationally, which we are so thankful for. Amen.